We are 32 days to the national elections, and the surveys have been consistently showing a presidential frontrunner. What does that tell us about the Filipino people's aspirations? Can the underdog still pull off a surprise? In our weekly segment, Political Capital, we speak with key leaders in the world of business and academe about what's at stake in the 2022 elections. And for today, we are joined by Dean Ronald Mendoza of the Ateneo School of Government. Hi, Dean. Thank you so much for joining us this morning.
Thank you so much, Mimi. Good morning.
All right. So, Dean, everybody says that politics is addition. Well, if you look at the survey, it's been pretty consistent. Former Senator Bongbong Marcos is leading the pack, far from everyone else. His number is more than double his distant second and hitting a majority. Is it safe to say at this point that the only chance he doesn't win is if everybody else teams up and give way to just one opposition candidate?
I would rather not speculate on what that result would be. And I think most people expect that a teaming up, a unified opposition may actually be quite helpful. And of course, that's a reasonable expectation. But I do think that the trends point towards still a possibility for changes in the coming weeks, although as you mentioned, it's now a very, very short runway to the elections. We will need to see, you know, really major changes taking place on a weekly basis if this thing is going to change at all.
And based on what we're seeing in the surveys, what do Filipinos seem to want for the next 6 years? What if you look at these surveys?
Yes, I think from our own survey group, which is called Boses Pilipinas, as well as from my review of the major credible surveys conducted by SWS and Pulse Asia. I think really the economy and things related to the economy are top of mind among voters. Jobs, high prices of basic commodities, and of course, health comes in there as well. As well as health expenditures, to the extent that the pandemic risk is still quite large. However, I think the interesting thing is to analyze whether those hierarchy of needs of wants actually is reflected in the vote in their preferred candidate, and I think this is where increased clarity. In terms of the debates, in terms of the media coverage, in terms of the campaigns themselves, should try to help our people better decide and become better informed to try and make more informed decisions in May. And actually there, I would just quickly mention that we have a project called Participate. And this is an initiative that is actually designed to help voters gather better information and in a way also counteract disinformation and malinformation in order to make better informed decisions for me.
Dean, that assumes that Filipino voters are issue-centric, that they vote based on issues that matter to them versus that we have a personality politics.
Yes, and that's a big assumption. And actually, the evidence suggests that voters are also very emotional creatures. We tend to think about some key issues, but in the end, we may also be swayed by emotion, and that's less linked to the policy issues, and more linked to the personalities and which particular candidates are best able to connect with voters. I think the candidates' narratives are also quite powerful if they are able to reach voters in time. These narratives could be quite powerful in convincing them to support certain candidates. But you are right that policy issues are not necessarily always translated into actual votes, it seems, based on the evidence and literature that I've seen.
Dean, you talked about economy as being one of the top issues. We have this just in. Jobless rate coming in at 6.4%. percent. When you look at the economy that the next president will inherit, it's an economy that's, you know, saddled with a pile of debt, still with the impact or the spillover effects from the COVID-19 pandemic and the lockdowns, the recession, the first one we've had in decades. What do you think should be the first order of business, economic and business-wise, for whoever wins the elections? What should be EO number one?
Well, I'm not sure about EO number one itself, but certainly the appointments in the key agencies should help restore the credibility of these agencies, at least in the eyes of the people and our partners, our development partners. I think the appointments to the economic team will be very, very important. It's important to continue some of the good that we have been able to achieve during this administration, but also to promote things that may not necessarily have been strengthened during the last 6 years, such as the inclusiveness of our growth trajectory. Mm-hmm. And there, I think an economic team that appreciates governance, because it's easy to liberalize sectors, very difficult to improve governance to strengthen our supply side. And that's really the part that is crucial in terms of inclusive development. We have the growth due to the the sound economic reforms that we have been pursuing, but we don't have the inclusiveness because the governance is still lacking. Mm-hmm. The second, I think, key appointment will have to do with health and social protection, and then a third would be education. Mm-hmm. Health and social protection, because it's still very much a pandemic aftermath condition for us, and it's crucial that we resuscitate the confidence in our economy, resuscitate the confidence in our recovery, in our inclusive recovery, such that it's not just based on luck, no, just based on the absence of a new variant. And it does seem to be the case that new variants are still a potential threat. And the third one, as I mentioned, is education. I think this crisis has also uncovered the weaknesses in our education system. And thanks to the recent data gathering as well in terms of PISA, we do know that we have a lot of catching up to do in this particular sector.
Mm-hmm. Dean, what do you think about one of the big economic legacies of Mr. Duterte, liberalizing certain aspects, specifically the Public Service Act amendments that allows 100% foreign ownership of critical sectors, utilities, for example, transportation, telecommunications. We had an investment banker, Stephen Konyang, the other day, and he was saying, well, he celebrates most of the liberalization attempts. This one, the PSA, is something he's very wary of, because he says it's better to have it run by a local very poorly than have it run by a foreigner, because these foreigners, once they don't see enough profit in it, can just back away very easily and drop us. What do you think about that?
That has happened before, actually, as I understand the literature and policy experience in other parts of the world. Mm-hmm. I know some water concessions in Africa were just dropped by foreign investors when it became sort of less profitable for them and the political risk increased. So those types of conditions can be there, and those are things to watch out for. I think generally, and that's really going to be my main focus on my comment in terms of President Duterte's economic reform legacy, it's a mixed bag. Mm-hmm. It's a mixed bag, I think, because there are many good things that they did push. Reforms that even previous administrations were not able to push. You have the tax reforms, you have the fiscal incentives reforms, you have the rice tariffication, and now amendments to the Public Services Act. I think these are all useful in an environment where the rule of law is strong, where governance is strong, where there is a reform effort to strengthen the supply side, so that when we liberalize, we don't end up exposing major parts of our society and major parts of our economic sectors to competition that they are not prepared to meet. Mm-hmm. And I think this is the second part that is much more important for promoting inclusive development, promoting inclusive growth, because strengthening the supply side will help ensure that the benefits from liberalization are widely shared, not just shared by a particular sector that happens to grow fast and increase its wealth dramatically, but broadly shared by all Filipinos, including those who are looking for decent work. And that's really what has been missing. So my assessment, overall assessment, is that it's a mixed bag. I think we are good at liberalizing, it seems, even beyond President Duterte. So not just him, but the track record of the past 30 years post-EDSA administrations, it seems, is promoting some of these important economic reforms, but we're lagging in terms of the important governance and political reforms. So I'm trying to advance this observation that we have managed to liberalize our economy, but we have not liberalized our politics, and therefore our governance is weak, and therefore our supply side, our ability to boost our domestic sector to compete has not actually progressed that much.
That is a very tall order for the next president to address. Speaking of inclusive growth, Bangsamoro, it used to be, you know, it was headlines a few years back. What about the Bangsamoro? What should voters there demand from the next administration?
The Bangsamoro is also basically a gain, a victory for the Duterte administration, that they have been able to keep on building on that peace process and strengthen the autonomy in that part of our country. However, again, it's a mixed bag because the capability, the transition, not necessarily smooth. And if I may say, the ones in charge of that transition have been pulled into the pandemic response. So it doesn't seem to me that enough focus was given on the Bangsamoro transition in order to strengthen it further. And there were a lot of pressures in that part of the country because of the very short runway given to them. That was, of course, extended. The, I guess the effort of the next administration should be to focus on really jump-starting that part of our country in terms of the economic stimulus, foreign investments, domestic investments, but also in terms of fixing the health response, the pandemic management response, because the latest information coming out of the region is that, well, first of all, we flagged since last December that there is vaccine inequality in the country. The vaccinations, if you look across the regions, Bangsamoro is the last. And, you know, maybe the first challenge was to vaccinate our main economic engines, the regions where our main engines are. But that was, you know, basically we have more vaccines since this year, and one hopes that there will be a massive dramatic catch-up in BARM. And it seems right now that the information coming from the region is that that catch-up is quite slow, and without that vaccination it's difficult to imagine how inclusive the recovery will be for BARM and the lingering risks in terms of a possible surge in that part of our country. So that part, the health response, it needs to be strengthened in BARM. The capacity building for the BARM government and our stakeholders there, that needs to be strengthened further by the administration. And I think an appointment, a key appointment in that part of the country where there will be strong focus on getting the job done is also a key thing.
Dean, I remember when President Duterte won the election, there were high hopes that finally the spotlight was going to be shared and Mindanao would enjoy a lot of attention from the national government because the president is coming from Mindanao. Did the president deliver on that?
I think to some extent he did. Well, the passage of the law itself and some infrastructure projects that were pipelined for Mindanao. I'm not sure to what extent they've actually started. I think many are delayed, but I think there was an early effort to try and focus there. That has since dissipated a bit, I think, because of, again, I mentioned the unclear transition, the lack of focus in the end part of the administration in that part of the country, and it's unfortunate that the vaccine inequality actually reflects that BARM is actually very much lagging behind.
All right. Dean, I want to go back to the political side of things. I saw you had an interesting post, very interesting one, last March 23, where you talked about, and I think we have graphics of what you wrote on your Facebook account. You said, "More than any survey, I'm inclined to trust the so far superb survival instincts of two butterfly species, the Joeyus salcedeus and Pantaleonus alvarezus. Their ability to sniff danger and their next meal from afar is quite uncanny. It's not uncommon for the rest of the butterfly herd to follow these two. Indeed, the political animal kingdom, some of them become fat, lazy, and slow, while others, like these two, are quite active, jumping from flower to flower, always one step ahead than most of the herd. Maybe it's because they never bothered to build a fat butterfly clan. That means they really have to be on their toes and remain agile all the time. I actually admire these two for their political survival skills. I think the fat and lazy in the political animal kingdom think they're on top of the food chain when in fact they're perfect next meals for the agile." These two personalities you mentioned, they're now backing Lenny Robredo. What does that mean? How do you make sense of that?
Yes, okay. Thank you for overexposing that post, Mimi. I did not expect to be talking about it this morning, but that was, of course, made in jest, but also slightly reflecting some truth. And, of course, all due respect to Gov Joey, who is a good friend and a partner in reform. Everyone knows that people chide him for his ability to switch sides in our very noisy political system. And I actually admire him for his standard response at this point, which is his main loyalty is to the people of Albay. It's really what your main loyalty should be if you are a local government official. I do think that the situation right now is crucial because you can see any number of local leaders basically now switching sides, partly because of the recent poll results, but also because of the political winds that they may be sensing at this point. And some are very good at sensing these winds early on and have been, in my view, good predictors of where the political chess pieces will end up. And so that's why I said in slight jest, but also in reflecting some truth, that some of these leaders, when they switch sides, these are signals. And we should continue to monitor them because they do signal potential changes to come.
Okay, very interesting. Dean, before we let you go, I wanted to go over all of the leading presidential candidates and maybe get your take on what they represent. You know, politics is all about branding, whether it's genuine or just perception-wise. It's all about their branding and how they engage the Filipino people. If I may quickly get your assessment on the sort of branding presented by some of the presidential candidates. Let's start with the front runner, Bongbong Marcos. I mean, six administrations after the collapse of his father's dictatorship, the brand still sells.
Yes, and it's unclear to what extent that brand reflects the truth. Sometimes because if you consider the history, certainly the Marcos martial law history, as well as both political and economic track records during that time, it's basically a tarnished brand, right? It's not necessarily a brand you want to pick up and use if you want to run for office. And yet, there's a lot of misinformation, disinformation, malinformation that seems to be changing the perception of those times. Some call it historical revisionism, some call it historical denialism. And I think it's unfortunate because during the past 30 years, the post-EDSA administrations, a whole new generation of voters has actually been born and now will be entering the voting population. And so there's an important role for history. There's an important role for data and evidence. And certainly there is an important risk, critical risk posed by misinformation, disinformation, and malinformation floating around in social media and other forms of media.
Dean, it's very easy. Dean, it's very easy to understand how people of a certain age, like if you're aged 35 and below, you didn't live through martial law. You would only know about it through the books that you read, through stories shared by family. But even from those belonging to the age who lived through martial law, you're still seeing pretty strong support. What does that tell us?
It tells us that the information and the knowledge and the wisdom that we take away from those times, we still have a lot of work to do. Mm-hmm. Certainly during that period, some regions, some sectors, some groups, communities in our country were more hardly hit
than
by
others.
Martial law years compared to others. Mm. And so it's understandable that some don't necessarily appreciate the depth of the malgovernance that took place during that time. And so I think it's uneven in that sense. Mm-hmm. There's also a lack of appreciation of how malgovernance, bad governance, can damage everyone's future. And to the extent that you somehow associate with the post-EDSA administrations the lack of energy, the lack of water, the poor road conditions, the poor infrastructure investments, and the high debt burden, if you associate it with them rather than the Marcos years, then you totally misunderstood the economic malgovernance that took place, because the post-EDSA administrations were the ones who slowly, in a non-linear way, however, fixed the problems and fixed the institutions over time.
All right.
I'll give you an example. The Bataan Nuclear Power Plant, which is a nuclear power plant that was supposed to generate a lot of energy resources for us, was never operated and did not sort of generate the energy that we expected it to generate. Mm-hmm. And it was fully paid in the mid-2000s by the Philippines. And then shortly after, you see an economic renaissance for us when we are able to get those heavy anchors off the backs of our economy. That's when you see some dramatic improvements in the Philippines, because of our improved procurement processes, our improved budget processes, our improvement in our Banco Central of the Philippines, and many other institutional reforms that allow foreign investors, creditors, to again consider us as a country worth trusting, as a country with strong institutions and strong macro fundamentals.
It's a very extensive discussion there, Dean. We don't have much time, but very quickly, just to go over the other personalities, Lenny Robredo, VP Lenny Robredo, and what some say will be a very Pinoy kind of leadership. That's the expectation of some, that if she wins, it's going to be pretty much the same as Pinoy's presidency. Quick comment. Is that a good thing or is that a bad thing?
Actually, I think that's incorrect. I do not agree with that assessment. At best, I would say it's yes and no. Mm-hmm. Yes, in the sense that some of the good governance reforms, some of the emphasis on institutional reforms, emphasis on human capital investments, I expect this from a Robredo administration, because that's really some of the policy reforms that she has championed and is still championing as vice president. But I do not think that it will be an Aquino 2 administration all over again, in the sense that I think President Robredo would push for deep governance and political reforms. She is actually open to looking at some of the deep reforms that is needed by the country, including some of the advocacies that many of the political reform advocates have been pushing for a long time. She's looking at political party reforms, for instance. I think she mentioned campaign finance reforms at some point. A reform of the party list was something I think that she mentioned at one point or the other. And I know that she's a champion of dynasty regulation, which is also key in order to carve out space for new alternative reform-oriented leaders. And I'm happy that there is a sense that it's not about being anti-dynasty, it's about regulating the number of people from each family that could run for office. So it's really a regulation that is meant to increase political competition.
All right. How about Isko Moreno? He's selling himself as the action guy, Bilis Action, who says, you know, we've done it in Manila, we can do it in the Philippines. Very much the hope that Mr. Duterte sold when he was running in 2016. I did it in Davao, I can do it in the Philippines.
Yes, Mayor Isko is actually, for me, a very interesting phenomenon, a very good addition to the choices for our people, if you ask me. Some would say that it's better if he coalesced with the rest of the opposition. that may actually be a good option for him too. But I do think that us getting to know some of our young up-and-coming mayors as potential presidential candidates is a good thing. He's different from a Mayor Duterte in the sense that he's very young and very, very new to the position, and yet he has been able to evoke a sense of urgency, a sense of speed in terms of some of their efforts in Manila. And certainly, I think the pandemic management of Manila has been one of the bright lights if you're looking at you know, how we managed the pandemic in the past 2 years.
All right.
I also think Mayor Risco is worth watching out for because of his very strong ability to communicate to our youth.
Yeah.
And I've also sort of described him as Obama-like in other interviews, in the sense that he is able to engage our young people in their language, in a language that they can appreciate, hopefully both in terms of intellectually and also in terms of the emotions.
All right. How about Manny Pacquiao, the people's champ, even outside of the ring?
Yes, San Manny is obviously one of those examples of basically a Cinderella story for the Philippines. And I think Filipinos love that kind of a story where you come from very humble beginnings and become sort of world known and then becomes a leader in our political system. I do think he carries a little bit of baggage, though, in the sense that he and his family have also begun to form a little bit of a dynasty.
Yes.
In their part of the country as well. But otherwise, I really like some of the emphasis that he has been communicating during the campaign. It's less focused on religion and more focused on poverty reduction and fairness and reduction of inequality.
Okay.
Which I think is a very good message to carry over. And obviously, he comes from Mindanao as well. Mindanao, which is trying to catch up with the rest of the country. And so his voice is an important voice in this campaign.
And finally, Senator Panfilo Ping Lacson and his brand of no corruption. You know, he's saying he has the experience, he has the job resume to show for it.
Yeah, Sen Ping, I think, is also a very welcome addition to the options. And again, barring a unified opposition slate at some future point, which you know, some people expect should be the next step at this stage.
Mm-hmm.
I do think that for us getting to know a candidate like Sen Ping, if we had a primary, it's good to know a Sen Manny, a Sen Ping, Mayor
Isko.
VP Lenny, sort of coalesce in terms of differences, but also the similarities and coherence in their policy messages. And Sen Ping has been by far the one that sort of communicates the anti-corruption message, I think, most effectively and most strongly. I do think, however, that it would be good also for Sen Ping to emphasize systems. In terms of, you know, they had a question the other night, tao ba o sistema? And many of them answered tao. I think basically Sen Ping also mentioned that people make a big difference. But actually systems do get some people elected more easily than others. And if your system is broken, then all you have are fat dynasties to choose from.
Mm-hmm.
It's very difficult to imagine that they will all advance good governance and anti-corruption. Just like Sen Ping is trying to advance right now.
Mm-hmm.
But I do admire him for his candor and his voice during the last 6 years, trying to emphasize good governance and anti-corruption during times when many of our political leaders just wanted to be part of a supermajority, just wanted to be part of the, you know, powerful clique.
Oh.
Sen Ping had no problem sort of standing out and saying what needed to be said.
All right. On that note, Dean, thank you so much for your thoughts this morning. Of course, the Filipino people votes on May 9th this year. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you, Mimi. Take care.
Take care.